Before I'm going to start, well, first of all, I want to thank the organizers of Boycott. You guys should give them a big hand for getting this all here to this location. I think it's absolutely fantastic what you're doing. You know, the biggest problem is when you are a walk on stage, which I am, because this is basically, since my very, very first speech that I gave in Taiwan in 2005 in front of 500 Chinese and Taiwanese journalists, I was so nervous, so I just started to walk all over the stage, and somehow it became a bad habit. But the problem right now is I forgot this little clicking machine, so I constantly have to go back to the laptop and change the slides. So my name is Sascha Partner. I'm originally from Dortmund, Germany, and I live in Taipei, Taiwan. This is the Taipei 101, the former tallest building in the world before the build of Burj Khalifa. By the way, have you any idea who built this tower? And who also built the Petronas Tower? And who also built the Burj Khalifa? I think some of you guys have thought of this company. Samsung. I won't believe it. Samsung is also building skyscrapers. Let me tell you a little bit about Taiwan. Here's a little overview of the 10 most app-crazed countries in the world, and you notice immediately that in general, Asian people just love to download apps. It's kind of funny. Sometimes it seems they're even downloading apps while they're riding on their scooters. When you're looking through Taipei, and we can tell by the way they're driving, it's just absolutely terrible. This is where I live. I pretty much live next to the jungle. It's a southeastern Taipei. That's the MRT line, which is a computer-driven train. By the way, we have free Wi-Fi all over Taipei, which is also a plus. That's something that I really enjoy. The problem is with this little pond down here in the summer. This is just terrible. I was already close to put some detergent into this pond to kill these frogs. Seriously, I had some crazy ideas about this. It's very annoying. This hall is also an older picture, very first Sony tablet, and I think they always have a booth over here where you can take a look at the Xperia Z2 tablet, which is a fantastic tablet, by the way. So this is basically how it looks in Taiwan in their MRT station, which is a subway. It's all about tech. You won't see kind of hair products, campaigns over there. It's all about the smartphones, tablets, computers, and all these things, so they're changing this like once a week. This is so cool about Taipei. This is at every subway station. So you have a little desk for your notebook, a power outlet to recharge the notebook, and also a USB that is coming out of the wall so you can charge your smartphone. It's on every little station. And over here you can see that's a sign from Taipei free Wi-Fi. Even as a tourist over there, and get free Wi-Fi access. What I'm doing is basically traveling the world and looking for new technologies. So these are my Foursquare logins of the last 12 months. I've been around a little bit. I also have to be very, very careful because I need to be in Taiwan for 108 days a year because otherwise I'm losing my resident card. So I need to look that up when I'm coming back by the end of this month to see if I can travel any further. What I would like to talk about is a little bit about the mobile evolution, because to understand what's the next big thing, you really need to understand where this is actually coming from. About 4 weeks ago, I've been at a conference in the German business magazine, Handelsblatt, in Düsseldorf, and I had all the executives and CEOs, it was all like professor, doctor, doctor, whatever. So these guys are making decisions. And whenever I see a keynote of people talking about the year 2030 and how the world will look like, I'm just wondering how can they guess this? How can you make a prediction of the future of technology, the future of mobile will look like in 10, 15, or 20 years? I can't even do this for 3 years. But I want to give you an idea what's going to happen in the next 2 or 3 years so that you will understand, especially when you're a developer, which future platforms might be very, very interesting for you. So it's basically the question of how we got from here to here. When we're talking about the very, very first phone that got invented, we always have the name Bell in our heads. But this guy, it's a German guy, Johann Philipp Reis, already had a patent on this little device over here. you see sometimes technology needs a little bit longer to develop. I even remember this one from my grandparents. I think right now you can get this in an antique shop or something, right? It's very designy. And then those were the other ones that came out in the 70s. And that's another interesting development, because this was actually shown over here in Berlin for the very first time. That was the very first public phone cell, invented by Wilhelm Quandt in 1904. He was from Wuppertal in Germany. And some of you guys can still remember this one. Well, that one. I'm always wondering who's actually using them. Everyone has a smartphone, or everyone has a cellular phone right now, but they're still around, they're still building, and they don't look cheap at all. To understand the development of the mobile internet, we have to go, well, this is almost 60 years back, 56 years back. The very first ANET came out. That was the very first mobile network in Germany. It was more for the privileged, for politicians, all those guys. Then in 1992, we had the introduction of the DNET. And then Echo, like this, it's just got that boring. I mean, you guys can just look it up and just search on Google for it. I think we really need to talk about the guys that are visionaries out there and that are talking about technology in the future, and we're inventing technology of the future. The guys that basically make impossible things possible for us right now. The guys that came up with ideas like this. This is the first kind of version of a mobile Skype that got introduced by Panasonic in the 1950s. Or we can talk about smartwatch. This is a smartwatch that's actually about 15 or 20 years old. Sorry? Is one of the abacus less than 10 years old? Okay, that's about 10 years old. Cheers. Man the man, this guy is doing smart glasses for about 30 years. This is his first wearable computer that he invented in the early 90s. Well, now it looks like this. I'll mention my shirt today. The inventor of the BlackBerry, do you know this guy? Here we go. So, Nikola Tesla wrote an amazing article back in 1909 in the magazine for popular mechanics. An inexpensive instrument, slightly bigger than a watch, would enable very quickly anywhere to see all that music or something. It would be possible for a businessman in New York to dictate instructions and have them instantly appear in time at his office in London or elsewhere. So this is basically the idea of a BlackBerry. This is the idea of mobile messaging. And this is something that he came up with about 105 years ago. Do you know this one? He's an author, Stanislaw Lem. And he wrote a really interesting novel, Return from the Stars. I spent the afternoon in the bookstore, there were no books in it. None had been printed for nearly half a century. The bookstore was settled instead in an electronic laboratory. All the functions fit into one pocket, though there must have been almost 300 titles. So he not only invented the idea of the Kindle, but also distribution channel for it. The inventors of cloud computing. I think it started like 5 years ago, this crazy buzzword. You couldn't go to any conference in the world without hearing this buzzword of cloud computing. As soon as you said something about cloud computing, everyone was like, oh wow, what's cloud computing? It's got the moment. Actually, it was a collaboration between the MIT and IBM. You can look up a little video on YouTube. It's called Time Sharing Solution to Computer Bottlenecks. Those were the days when people thought, okay, you know, we might need like 5 or 6 huge computers in our world. So what they did was basically creating a separate client architecture. So you were able to rent time, computing and processing time on one of these huge mainframe systems. You know this one? That's Alan Kay. He's the inventor of the iPad. What you see over there is a little device that he came up with in the late 60s. actually made for children. He wanted to kind of revolutionize the education market with it. What's quite interesting is that those guys in 1989 came up basically with a one-by-one copy of the Dyna book. And they were kind of wondering why is that, especially Apple, suing everyone just because of raw edges. And sometimes you wonder, how can this, is this guy able to come up with a slide like this, like saying, you know, now all these other guys are also building tablets or copycats. They've been doing this for all of the whole history of this company. Our case joined Apple in the 80s, came from Rex Ayres, and he made a statement to Steve Jobs before they started the development of the iPad. Make the screen 5 inches by 8 inches, you would rule the world, which is basically the display size of the original iPad. And here's the big question. What's going to be the next big thing? Is it going to be smart glasses? They've been, especially with this one here, they became quite popular, created a lot of hate also in societies. Actually, I've been using mine. I had the first generation of the Explorer Edition. I got it back in September last year. This is the second generation, so I have prescription glasses in it. And I really tried so hard to understand the device itself. And whenever I'm having a speech about Google Glass, and I'm telling the audience that this isn't anything for the average user, they're disappointed, especially when they're playing around with it. And they're all in awe because the voice recognition is amazing, the connection to the Google Knowledge Graph is absolutely amazing. When you're recording videos and it has no optical image stabilizer at all, right? But you can still walk around, it almost looks like a $100,000 Steadicam from Hollywood because your neck is actually your image stabilizer. You can just walk up the stairs and it's amazing. But this is just, you know, what you're expecting and what you experience in the first 2 weeks of using Google Glass. That is getting quite boring because you just don't know what to do with it. I'm not walking around taking pictures all the time. By the way, this second edition, or the second generation of the Explorer Edition, has a little sensor that is kind of tracking my eye. And I can switch it on to take pictures at the blink of an eye. Which was kind of annoying because it was switched on by default on the first day I ended up taking 500 pictures or so. The other one is you have this kind of, you can just switch it on by tapping on the right side, but